What do we want? When do we want it?
Now.
Excellent. We're going to get it, too.
Climate rally. Climate march.
How are we doing
rally,
our photographer here?
Last one you on the face of the earth
okay.
for today. In front of the Gandhi statue.
Yeah, we're going to have a couple of tunes. We got, please down, relax. Rico's going to start out with a little bit of
around,
music here. And we're going to have some speakers here pretty soon to
Gandhi
tell you exactly what's going on with NextEra and about
around. We just marched through Waikiki, both sides of the sidewalk.
Does everybody, if everybody doesn't have one of these, please get one from me. Everybody should have one of these in your hand.
If
anybody who has extra flyers, could you bring them up here? Or distribute them in our group. Make go around, make sure he's got flyers.
I have the speakers and some music. Sorry for the bumpy picture.
We have our wonderful friend, Luke
March, but it was a handheld.
He's going to play some music for us.
There.
Lauren found out that there's an outlet over there. There's been an outlet there this entire time. 4 years ago, there was an outlet there, too. An outlet where people can charge things.
Now we know. 4 years ago, that was Laulani. She was camped out here protesting APEC.
Does everybody have a flyer?
Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation secret meeting. She'll be playing music here momentarily.
Okay, there's going to be a quiz later, so y'all have to have your flyer. So I have my two wonderful friends here, Marlani Teal. Applause. And Hawaiian music legend, Liko, who's going to do some wonderful music for us.
We're in front of this, you can see that mound there. There's a lot of the remains found in Waikiki are interred there.
Festival 2. Okay, here we go. That's good. Too hot. Take it down a little bit more. Just a bit, yeah. Testing 1, 2, 3. How's it going, honey?
Thanks for the crowd. Nico Martin. Hold on to you. Nico wrote the unofficial anthem of the Hawaiian movement, Hawaii Loa, all the way stands together.
This is where I grew up. I was 5 years old. I made my first escape from school, kindergarten. From that school right over there. So I know this place real good. And here's some songs for you. There are islands in the sun, amongst the moon and stars above. We are children in the fields, amongst the rivers and the seas. To sit down and count your blessings, one by one. Funny, I wrote this song up in Portland. One day I was sitting on the hill and this song came to me, and then I went down to LA and finished. Really simple, you know. And there are islands in the sun,
islands in
amongst the
sun,
moon and stars above. And we are children in the fields amongst the rivers and the seas. Sit down and count your blessings one by one. And remember, we are an island under the sun. Time may come when everyone will join their hearts in threatened by the destruction of our world. Once a forest, then a city, from mountains to the sea. We can turn our backs on Babylon and count our blessings one by one.
Moon and stars above,
amongst the rivers and the
seas.
So sit down and count your blessings one by one. And remember, we are an island.
Waikiki at the rally right after the climate march.
Mahalo everybody, and mahalo from walking the walk through Waikiki. It's very important. This is a whole lot more. That line between the ocean and the shore right there is a lot more than a photographic opportunity. It's the place where the great ocean meets with that precious land that we have, that we call home, and the only place we have to live on. And the only place that there will be to go, as we're the high ground in the Pacific. So mahalo for walking to protect that, to keep that line from disappearing, from making the land disappear before our eyes.
Well, there's nowhere to go. It's a mighty wide ocean. The sky's falling down in tears. Sitting in the park, I heard Sunday school lessons all preached to me about a living dream. And what would it matter if the rains never splattered on the hoofs of the thundering sea? We're living on this earth of molten lava, oozing out in rivers to the sea. There's nowhere to go. It's a mighty wide ocean, and the sky's falling down. Sunday school lessons all preached to me about a living dream. But hold on, what's that sound? It don't sound good to me. There's nowhere to go for city souls but bad. Cause it's concrete over dust and money you can't keep it in your pocket. And bombs, they don't have to fall on green, ocean, and the sky's falling down in tears. Sitting in the park, I heard some school lessons preached to me about a living dream. But hold on, what's that sound? It don't sound good to me. There's nowhere to go for city souls but bad.
Polar bear.
I love you.
Yeah, you do.
Okay.
Hello, polar bear.
Hi.
Welcome to Hawaii.
Well, thank you.
Can you guys hear the polar bear?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay. What's your name?
My name is Frosty.
Frosty the polar bear. Woo. What? It's kind of funny that a polar bear here be here in Hawaii. Isn't it kind of too hot for you to be on vacation in Hawaii?
Well, you know, I'm here to acclimatize. You know, it's getting hot up in the Arctic.
Wow.
And my friends and I want to know what it's going to be like, what we're going to have to deal with. Plus, I hear, Dave, that there's a hot real estate market here. So I'm here to offer you folks, if anybody wants to buy a nice iceberg.
An iceberg for sale.
Nice
wow,
iceberg.
Anybody buy an iceberg? Wait a minute. Icebergs, don't those melt?
Well, yeah, but you got to buy it real fast.
Yeah, buy it fast.
I'll give you a deal.
Well, you know, there actually is something we could do about global climate change and you know, to mitigate it and make it better.
Really?
Yeah, there's a couple of things. And I think you guys have your flyer. Everybody got your flyers? Y'all got your flyers? There's a couple of things. One, we want to let the world leaders know, the global leaders know. Oh, here we go. The global leaders know in Paris right now that are meeting that we demand that they do something about climate change now. We have to do something about it. Otherwise, our island is going to be gone. And each one of you here can help us do that by going to that website.
Roger.
We have extra flyers if you want to take some with you to share with your friends and families and distribute. Come up and get some from us and you can take them and give them out. So, and then the other thing is to say no to NextEra. NextEra is a company that wants to take over Hawaiiantel and also get rid of solar in Florida. There basically isn't a whole lot of solar gone because of NextEra, and we have the best solar we call that coverage in here in Hawaii because we got all these solar panels on our rooftops, but NextEra would stop that. And we want to be independent, right? We want to be independent. Yeah, okay.
NextEra. Terror. Oh, that doesn't sound very good to me.
Yeah, it is kind of scary, but there is something you can do about it.
Well, I hope the public utility folks
yes.
vote no.
Right, we want the pod. So everybody, if you got your iPhones now, if you haven't done so yet, go to the QR code. You can take the QR code. How about you? You going to sign up, Bear?
Well, it's kind of hard with these paws to use a pen, but...
Can't do it with a pen. Okay,
you know.
But we do have, if you want to sign up over here on this table, you can sign up for Nota NextEra and International. There's Sherry, the lovely Sherry.
Oh, thank
copy.
You. And
go to the website.
If I had my cell phone with me,
yes,
I would be using those codes.
Okay,
so
anybody,
could all
that?
Of you put your cell phones out and scan the code
scan
and
the
sign
code.
It for me? Thank you.
Where are you going to go now?
Well, if somebody could help direct me to a shave ice stand,
anybody
I'd
can
really
find our
appreciate
our bear.
It.
Okay.
Awesome.
Thank you, polar bear.
Thank you, Dave.
Okay, next we have up is Gary Hoosier, and I don't have my piece of paper. Where is it? Right. There we go. Okay, where is Gary? Ah. Gary Hoosier is a county council member from Kauai. He's a former Hawaii State Senator and presently serves on the Kauai Council. He's a founder of the board and president of HAPA, the Hawaii Alliance for Progressive Action. Welcome everybody, Gary Hoosier, who's a great human being.
Aloha. I want to thank everyone. Thank everyone for coming out today on a beautiful Sunday to spend your time walking together to help change the world. And I think, make no mistake about it, that's what we're here to do, is to help change the world. And we do it one step at a time, one person at a time, one issue at a time. I was asked earlier about climate change and global warming, and there's no question that this issue is the defining issue of our generation and the next generation too. And I woke up this morning, actually, I flew over from Kauai on the plane, and I was fairly depressed, and then I would get angry. I'd go from being sad to being mad, and thinking about the condition of the world, the harm that's coming to the world today as we speak. And then I was talking to a friend about what to do about this, and he reminded me that being angry doesn't solve any problems. You know, being angry doesn't help. Lashing out doesn't help. And so I should take a big, deep breath before I spoke today. And that's what I did. And, you know, on Kauai, we've been fighting a lot of fights. I've been in politics now for about 15 years and fought a lot of fights with a lot of people I see out here in the audience. And we've won a lot of times, too. We've won when we've all come together. We've won when we've all come together, when the Hawaiians and environmentalists from the Sierra Club and Surf Rider and all the various organizations all walk together is when we've won. And that's what we have to do now around the world and around the planet. And people are doing that today. They're marching all over the world in unity, and we have to do that. Yes, we have to do that. We have to keep doing that. On Kauai, I've been personally engaged the last 2 years of fighting with my community the four largest chemical companies in the world, the Monsanto, Syngenta's, BASF, Dow Chemical. And we've fought them, we've marched, we've held signs, we've gotten elected to office, and we're fighting them in the courts, and we're winning. It doesn't feel like we're winning sometimes, but we're winning. Our community is a safer place today than it was 2 years ago as a result of people marching in the streets and showing up like you're showing up here today. So don't get stuck in this rut that we're not winning, because we are. We're winning in many ways. You go in the stores, you see more and more of the foods are GMO-free, more and more foods are raised properly. And the same with the climate change issues. And it all revolves around the same ethic, the ethic of greed, the ethic of the corporatization of the world. So whether we're talking about food, chemical companies, banks, insurance companies, or oil companies, they're all driven, and the harm comes for the same purpose, and that's greed and making money. And we have to stand up and be willing to say that, and to say to put people in the environment first, above profits, above greed, over and over and over again. You know, I'm part of the system. I'm a county council member. I used to serve in the Hawaii State Senate. So I'm part of the system. I'm part of the politicians that vote, and part of the failed system, quite frankly. But I still struggle with this. What do we do? What do we do? What better system is out there? And I can't come up with a better system that's out there. So I've concluded that we have to take over and take back our system of government. We cannot give up on our system of government. We have to take it over and take it back. That means people like you, good people who share our worldview, have to be willing to stand up and be counted and run for office. And that means people like you have to stand up and be counted and support those people when they run for office. And you have to show up to vote. The numbers would show that half the people here today are not registered to vote. That's what statistics would say. Half of you are not registered to vote. The other half that are registered will not show up at the polls. And we have to change that. We have to change that. We have to show up. We have to take our government back. We're counting on you. Imoa, thank you.
Thank you, Gary. This is a wonderful human being. Now we have Brody Lockard. And Brody, oops, sorry about that. Brody has a bachelor's and a master's in education from Stanford. He's a grassroots organizing with Public Citizen. He's a volunteer for the Sierra Club. He's a board member of Hawaii Clean Elections and Hawaii Alaska Regional Coordinator for MoveOn.org. Currently, he's a board of Common Cause Hawaii and Hawaii Climate Lead for Organizing for Action. One of our founders of Hawaii Chapter of 350.org. Brody.
Aloha, thank you for coming. We're here today, along with a lot of other marches across the world, as of this morning, 2,472 other marches across the world, to send a strong, very strong message to the 190 world leaders in Paris that it's way past due to reach an agreement, to compromise, and cooperate and reach the strongest possible global agreement to finance a just transition to a clean energy economy and to keep fossil fuels in the ground.
Yeah.
.org got organized about a year ago in Hawaii at the same march, and with the help of a great number of other people, we were instrumental in getting UH to divest in May to take all their money out of fossil fuels. And we have more divestment campaigns to run. So if you would like to step up and help, please look for one of the clipboards that's circulating in the audience and sign up. If you know any union leaders, or if you know anyone on the board of directors or board of trustees of a large Hawaii organization like a hospital or a school, please check the box to the right. We could use that help. And we are going to be working on those campaigns very soon, so please sign up to help with that. The most important thing you can do today and any day is to spread the word, to educate your family, your friends, your coworkers, your neighbors. Tell them that the world is burning and we need to act now. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, Brody. I think we have State Representative Chris Lee somewhere in the audience here. There he comes. Some people tell you voting doesn't matter, doesn't make any difference. This is why voting matters. Him, Gary Hoosier, anyway, without these guys in there, in office, fighting for us, fighting for justice, fighting for climate, nothing would get done. So, you know, go out, vote often, vote as many times as you can for Chris. So here we have State Representative Chris Lee.
Thanks a lot. I didn't get the memo about the shirt color today, so. You know, about this time last week, I was sitting in the West Wing of the White House talking with the Chief of Staff to the President about one of their most important legacy issues, and that's climate. And that's everything that is going to be left to generations that will succeed them in the administration, and that will succeed us. And I'm more confident than ever that going into Paris this week, that there is a commitment, not just lip service, but an actual commitment to getting things done, to actually changing the trajectory that we're on. And we're starting to see that, not just here in the United States, but in nations around the world. And this is something that is incredibly exciting, because it means a change. And here in Hawaii, we are so lucky to have the environment that we have, these sunny days, that beach, but all of it is at risk, whether we like to admit that to ourselves or not. As we speak, Waikiki Beach is an artificial, partly artificial beach, which has to be replenished. Our businesses here are paying much more money to be able to restore that beach on a regular basis, because it's the centerpiece of this economy. And in communities around the state, our natural resources, whether it's our beach or our fresh water supply or our natural endangered species that we have here, more than anywhere else in the world, that face extinction as a result of warming temperatures, all these things are the centerpiece of our culture and our economy and what makes this home for all of us. Naomi Klein, I'm not about to go off into a 10-minute talk, but has everyone read, been through her book? Yeah? If you have it, I'm sure you've heard of her, because there's about 8 different people here with t-shirts that say the same. And what it talks about is the ability for people to get together and rise up and take control not only of our destiny, our cost of living, but also our future. The ability to change this trajectory that we're on. And that path forward is now being blazed ahead in states around the country because of the activism and the engagement that folks like you guys, like all of us, are starting to get together on. And so this year, I'm just so excited, because we have demonstrated success already. We have demonstrated a path forward. A year ago, so many of you were here, we were actually about a block that way, having the same discussion about what we were going to do. We were talking about hope, and we were relying upon it. But in that year, we've since become the very first state in the country to set a target, a binding law that's going to take us 100% off fossil fuels. That happened as a result of everybody here not just saying we have hope that that's going to happen, but actually standing up to make it happen. And we had hundreds of people at the state capitol. We had folks from the Blue Planet Foundation, Hank Rogers, not only talking about this, but putting their money where their mouth is, saying, you know what, this is important. It is our generation that is responsible for making change, and we're going to stand up to make it happen. That's what we've seen. But we're not done, because we've got so many more things that need to happen here. We're facing incredible change in our energy sector, here in our climate, and there are next steps. The folks from Surfrider, from Blue Planet, from all the different organizations who are involved are going to be reaching out to you, asking for your help. And when that happens, the challenge I pose to you is to ask yourselves what you're going to do when that call comes. What is it that you can do individually? More than show up at a rally, more than talk about it to your friends, what is it you can do to engage another person to the same level and the same degree to which you care? Because whether or not we win or lose these battles along the road to winning this war, we're only going to get there if we engage more people. And even if we don't succeed at every turn, having reached out to somebody else and got them to stand right here next to you as you scream at the top of your lungs, this has to happen, that puts one more person there with an equal voice to you, arguing for the same thing. And even if you don't win, you've doubled the amount of folks who are paying attention and who are actively engaged, and that is a victory. So we've got so many ways. We've got so many ways that folks can get involved. We're going to have to take action. Right now we've got, I'm not going to go on too much about it, there's a bunch of signs, that's the only reason why I'm going to talk about it right now. But we have to control our energy future here. And that means not ceding control of our cost of living and our energy resources to someone who's got, or some corporation that's got an intent to profit before putting our interests first as people. We can control our destiny. And of all the years, I've only been around for a few years, but I've been in office for 8 years. In that time, I think I can confidently say that I've never seen the amount of unity between Republicans and Democrats, politicians and the community, between the state and the counties, across all islands, coming together, stepping forward, saying we need to look at alternatives to the status quo. We need to do something that puts the interests of the people first, lest we enter a new century in which we are all subject to the same sort of status quo that has created some of these problems. And so we have the political will. We have the public support. Everybody knows what it means to be from Hawaii, to put our interests of the people and our neighbors and our families first. It's up to us to execute now, to look beyond the HECO or NextEra issue, beyond fossil fuels or renewable energy, and engage ourselves in this debate. Because none of it's going to change if there aren't folks stepping up to the table, and that's why it's so important, no matter what particular piece of this interests you most. And so that's the challenge I put forward. We're going to need your help. It cannot be done without you. But speaking with the same hope and enthusiasm that we did a year ago, saying we're going to achieve these things, and standing here today saying we did achieve these things, I have all the hope for the coming year that we're going to be able to do the same again. It relies on you. And so I thank you so much for staying involved. So thank you, everybody.
Vote for Chris Lee again and again. Our next speaker, we have our UH professor, Craig Perez. He's a Pacific Island poet. Craig Santos Perez is a native Chamorro from the Micronesian island of Guam. He has been an activist Pacific decolonization and demilitarization movement, and in 2008 testified at the UN, United Nations about environmental impacts of U.S. militarism on Guam, which we know is not a good thing. He is a poet and a professor at University of Hawaii Manoa, where he teaches courses in ecological poetry. He's also a participating scholar with the Asia Pacific Observatory and Project for Humanity's Environmental Initiative. Craig Santos.
Aloha kākou. So good to see all you folks out here doing the march, fighting for global climate change. Thank you to 350.org and all the partnering organizations for bringing us together today. As David mentioned, I'm from the island of Guam, and besides dealing with coral bleaching, ocean acidification, intensified storms, and earthquakes the past few years, one of our biggest struggles is against the U.S. military, which occupies 30% of our island and has been ecologically devastating our environment for the past 100 years. And as a lot of more people are talking about, is the U.S. military, as well as the global military industrial complex, is one of the largest emitters of fossil fuels and is often not required to report their carbon emissions. And so what I wanted to encourage folks today is that it's so important, as we move forward in this global movement, is to also come together with the demilitarization movement, which is very active here in Hawaii, throughout the Pacific, and around the world. The only way for us to, you know, to stick to our goals in terms of helping ourselves and protecting the planet as much as we can is to fight militarization as well. Now, of course, for the past couple decades, the military has not only been emitting all this carbon, but also so many of the wars has been about securing more fossil fuels, more oil fields. And this kind of military violence has, of course, led to massive displacements of people, leading to the global refugee crisis, which has been compounded by climate change as well. And so I just wanted to end my talk today with, you know, not only the message that climate change movement and demilitarization movement are vital allies, but also that, you know, one of the ways that we can attempt to fight and form solidarity is to care more, to bring our aloha to these movements as well. So I wanted to just close by sharing a poem. And I wanted to dedicate this poem to my daughter, who's in the audience in the back. This poem is called Care. My 16-month-old daughter wakes from her nap and cries. I pick her up, press her against my chest, and rub her back until my palm warms like an old family quilt. Daddy's here, Daddy's here, I whisper. Here is the island of Oahu, 8,500 miles from Syria. What if tropical trade winds suddenly became helicopters, flames, nails, and shrapnel indiscriminately barreling towards us? What if shadows cast against windows aren't plumeria tree branches, but soldiers and terrorists marching in heat? Would we reach the desperate boats of the Mediterranean in time? If we did, could I straighten my legs into a mast, balanced against the pull and drift of the current? Daddy's here, Daddy's here, I whisper. If we make landfall, will I be strong enough to carry my daughter across the razor wires of sovereign borders and ethnic hatred? Will I be strong enough to plead, please help us? Please just let us pass. Please, we aren't suicide bombs. Am I strong enough to keep walking, even after my feet crack like halabi pepper fields after 5 years of drought, after this drought of humanity? Trains and buses rock back and forth to detention centers. Yet what if we didn't make landfall? What if here capsized? Could you inflate your body into a buoy to hold your child above rising waters? Daddy's here, I whisper. Drowning is the last lullaby of the sea. To all the parents who braved the crossing, you and your children matter. I hope your love will teach the nations that emit the most carbon and violence that they should instead remit the most compassion. I hope soon the only difference between an illegal migrant and a legal refugee will be how willing we are to open our homes, offer refuge, and carry each other towards the horizon of care. Thank you so much. Mahalo.
That was amazing. Now we have Stanley Chang and Rebecca Soon, who are going to introduce each other. You can introduce Stanley too. Okay.
Perfect.
All right, here we go.
Aloha kākou. thanks so much for allowing us to be here today. Stanley's going to chat first. You may know him as a former council member representing this area from Hawaiʻi to Waikiki, but he's working on a lot of community-based issues still, even after being out of office, and I'll let him lead us off.
Aloha. It's great to see everybody here on a beautiful Thanksgiving weekend morning. I think you all deserve a big round of applause for being here and not out, you know, shopping or doing any of the other things that you could be doing right now. It's a really big honor for me to be here, and it's really important that we're all here, because actually, even though it might seem like we're just a distant place in the middle of the Pacific, far from where the real battles are being fought, you know, Hawaii actually is ground zero right now for the clean energy future of the world. And I'm talking specifically about the solar revolution that's happening in Hawaii. I'm talking specifically about the attempt to take over Hawaiian Electric by the Florida-based electric utility NextEra. Anyone been following the news about NextEra and the takeover of Hawaiian Electric? In my opinion, this is the single worst thing that could happen for Hawaii's clean energy future. And I'm a lawyer. I paid a lot of money to go to law school for 3 years, so I tend to see things in this legal way. And so the words that really come to my mind are conflict of interest. And the problem is that NextEra is one of these big, you know, industrial corporations. They have operations in 28 states and Canada. They're owned by shareholders. They're very good at making money for their shareholders. And that's their mission, is to generate profit for their shareholders. So when they want to come to Hawaii, and they want to, you know, they talk about changing Hawaii, what they really want to do is they want to profit off the people of Hawaii. And the way they want to profit off the people of Hawaii is through doubling down on fossil gas, on fossil fuels, on additional carbon, and delaying the renewable energy future revolution that's already happening today. They would be perfectly happy to install $30 billion worth, in their own numbers, $30 billion worth of infrastructure to build new natural gas pipelines and plants here in Hawaii to burn, and then to tear it all down, and then to charge us 10% on profit on top, an estimated $7,000 for every household in the state of Hawaii, that we would be writing a check to their shareholders in profit. How do we know this is true? We know this is true because they're doing it right now in Florida, where they're charging their own ratepayers in Florida to go exploring for fracking, for gas, all over the mainland. If they make money, their shareholders win, and if they lose money, their ratepayers, the people of Florida, are on the hook. That, my friends, is a conflict of interest. But we should all be proud of ourselves, because in Hawaii we've already made incredible strides to becoming the cleanest, most renewable jurisdiction in the world. We've set a 100% clean energy goal by 2045, thanks to the efforts of people like Representative Chris Lee, who we just heard from. About one-third of all houses in Hawaii today have rooftop solar. That's probably unprecedented in any community anywhere in the world. And in my humble opinion, all we need to do is to get rid of that conflict of interest, to ensure that our utilities' incentives are aligned with the people of Hawaii and with the planet Earth. And there's no better person in my mind to explain that than the woman standing next to me, Rebecca Soon, who has been tirelessly fighting on behalf of community causes, whether it's the environment, whether it's the Native Hawaiian community, for her entire life, which is not that long. But it's been a long time for her, and I'm really proud to call her a friend and a partner in bringing Hawaii to a clean energy future. Rebecca Soon.
Thanks, Stanley. So it's really appropriate, I think, that and impactful that we're standing here next to Gandhi, who is so much about empowering people and empowering communities, and who he himself, you know, coined the phrase that we all use over and over and over, to be the change you want to see in the world. And it's really amazing to be standing here and looking at all these faces who are literally sitting here. You walked here and are being that change, doing 1,000 things in your life to ensure that we are stopping climate change, that we are making the steps that we can make to have an impact on protecting this aina and protecting our entire world. You know, it's really hard for me to hear when we go around and talking to communities. It's hard for me to hear us talking about this possibility of bringing in LNG, which is just fancy words for fracked gas, from someone else's communities. I mean, here we fight for aloha aina, malama aina. We fight for knowing how important our land is, and yet we're going to someone else's land and ripping the natural resources out of it. It's sinking their homes. It's destroying their communities. It's really heart-wrenching for me to hear those, to be seeing in our communities that people are thinking that this might be a good thing. And we sitting here all know that it is dangerous to our world to be talking about that. What's also dangerous, though, is this idea that we're just pawns in our own energy future. The Hawaii Constitution is very clear that energy is a public trust resource. And we entrust and we provide a grant to our electric utility in order to provide the service to us and in order to make a reasonable profit off of doing so. But their first kuleana, their first obligation is to us. It's to you and you, and it's to every single one of us. And we cannot let them off the hook for ensuring that the kind of future that we want, the kind of future that I see written on all of these amazing signs, is the future that they're actually providing us. And you know, I find it to be an exciting moment, because even though NextEra offers, in my mind, everything that moves us in the opposite direction, both in terms of our climate future, as well as in terms of our control over our own public interest and our own public trust resource, I still find it an exciting time, because it means that we're having more of these conversations than we were having a year ago. And more people are thinking about the issues that I'm sure many of you have been fighting for years. And it's on the front of our newspaper, it's on our minds, it's filling up our social media feeds, because people are finally taking some of these questions more seriously and ensuring that we are all collectively responsible for our future. There's so much that we can do to be responsible for that future. One, we can just say no to NextEra. Yeah. We can say no to the idea that someone who lives in a distant community, who is not Ma'a, who is not familiar to the things that we care about in our community, that they're gonna take over and take control and take the profits and leave. We can say no to that too. We can say yes to controlling our own future. We can say yes to starting conversations in our households, in our communities, in the state legislature, among our policymakers, among our business leaders, among our business community. We can start conversations everywhere, and they are starting, about how we can take over control of our utility. Stanley often says, you know, we pay for it. We pay for the infrastructure. We pay for the rates. We pay for our utility. So why not own it? Sorry, I stole that one from you. But really, there really are real conversations happening, and there really are real opportunities, whether through a co-op model, through a municipal model, or through a community-based solution where we have investors that are living in this community and care about this community, that are really in charge and responsible to the people. We deserve a 100% clean, a 100% local future, and we can achieve a 100% clean, 100% energy future. So mahalo for all that you folks are doing. So Stanley and I are a team that works together with Earth Justice and with Sierra Club as interveners before the PUC. And there are a lot of ways for voices and community voices to still impact the process. So he's going to tell you how folks can be involved in the work that we're doing if you're interested.
So let me, right now is actually a really opportune time because tomorrow is the day that the Public Utilities Commission is going to be giving, it's going to be beginning its hearings on whether or not to allow the takeover of Hawaiian Electric by NextEra. And they actually want to hear your feedback. You can email your written feedback about the proposal to their email address, which is puc.comments@hawaii.gov. That's puc.comments@hawaii.gov. And in the email, you just want to refer to docket number 2015-0022. They have a big agenda, they have lots of dockets, and this is the one that is the NextEra takeover. That's the single most immediate thing you can do because the hearings are beginning, like I said, tomorrow morning. But you can also keep up the pressure on your elected officials. You can call them, you can write to them, you can ask for meetings with them, you can write letters to the editor, you can write op-eds for the paper, and when the legislative session comes around, I'm sure that our friends in the legislature will be introducing resolutions and bills to keep the momentum going. And those bills and those resolutions are going to need your help and your testimony too. So please stay active, please stay involved. We can make this happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Stanley. Okay. Our next speaker, we're going to have Mr. Bailey here introduce our next speaker. Come on up, Mike.
Greetings, aloha. My name is Michael Bailey. I'm actually here to introduce my next speaker. Just so you know, I am one of the original founding members of Greenpeace, ran the early expeditions to save the whales before beginning of time. And a key thing here is understanding sustainability of ourselves, our hearts, our souls, and keep ourselves enthused and inspired and having leadership amongst the movement. And one of the people I'm introducing right now, the next person, is a leader in Hawaii for the sustainability movement for energy alternatives. He recently returned to Hawaii from Denmark, where he was involved in looking at examining a completely 100% sustainable wind and solar powered township in Denmark. And he's been involved in amazing degrees of technology, understanding the degrees of technology necessary to change the planet for the better way. He's also the founder of the Blue Planet Foundation. Coming up, Hank Rogers, and say us a few words here. We have about 5 minutes. Thank you much, Hank. Good round of applause for Hank, a leader of all leaders.
Thank you very much. So 10 years ago, I found my mission in life, my first of four missions in life, and came in the back of a newspaper saying, we're going to kill all the coral in the world. And I said, no, we're not. That is not something that we're allowed to do. So I formed the Blue Planet Foundation, and you know, because the cause of that is the same as the cause of climate change, which is that we are putting carbon dioxide into the atmosphere at a prodigious rate. We are taking 200 years of buried fossil fuel. I mean, it took nature 200 years to bury it, and we're burning it every year. That cannot be sustainable. And so, since carbon dioxide is the danger point, and 350 is out here to tell you all about how that is the thing, my mission in life is to end the use of carbon-based fuel. And it should be all of your missions in life. Because this is the thing that is going to keep our world the way it is for our children, our grandchildren. I cannot imagine what the world will be like for them without a world without coral, a world with a 10-meter rise in sea level. I mean, we talk about it, but we don't think about it enough. So I've been traveling, as Michael said, I've been traveling. I've been looking for answers in other places, specifically in other islands. Last year, my wife and I went to Greenland, and Greenland has been fossil-free since 1972. And what do they use? They use hydro and they use geothermal. And why are they able to use geothermal and we are not? That is a big question that I find still unanswered. They make five times more energy than they need, and they, as a result, they have the cheapest energy prices in Europe, and they smelt aluminum of all things. They are able to do a business that requires importing of, anyway. We have solar and wind, and the good news is, by the way, we have turned a corner. I mean, the world has turned a corner. Solar and wind are now cheaper than fossil fuels. And so all the people who say they want to use fossil fuel because it makes them money or so on, it's not true. The truth is that solar and wind are cheaper. And so why are we still looking to things like liquefied natural gas, LNG, which is methane? Methane. It's methane. It's 96% methane. How dare they call it natural gas? It's methane. It's meth. It's the next disease that's going to hit Hawaii. If anything we can do that's going to help the future of Hawaii, it's to stop methane from coming into this state. Because we can do it with renewable energy. We don't have to spend $5 billion a year on oil. We don't have to spend any money on LNG. We can do this. Thank you very much.
Aloha, everyone. My name is Dave Mullenix. You may have seen me on the march. Now I'm going to be a musician. Uh-oh. Oh, we got more coming, but I'm going to do a song first. Oh. Okay. Nico's going to come up behind me. So this is a song that... you got it? Hear the guitar? Hear me? Okay. For everyone to get together. I'll stand with you. Will you stand with me? Will we be the change that we hope to see? In the name of love, in the name of peace. Will you stand with me? When injustice raises up its fist and tries to stop us in our tracks, we will join as one resists. No fear or sorrow harness us back. Join me. I will stand with you. Will you stand with me? Will we be the change that we hope to see? In the name of love, in the name of peace, will you stand? Will you stand with me? When hatred turns up angry noise and tries to shout down freedom's song, we will join one joyful voice, loud and clear and ever strong. Join me and you'll stand with me, and I'll stand with you. Will be the change that we hope to be. In the name of love, in the name of peace, will you stand, will you stand with me? When the brokenhearted come walking on our door, old and hungry, so alone, we will reach as we reached before. There are no strangers in our home. Join me. I will stand with you. Will you stand with me? Will we be the change that we hope to see? In the name of love, in the name of peace, will you stand with me? One more time. I will stand with you. Will you stand with me? The change that we hope to see. In the name of love, in the name of peace, will you stand with me? Together, music unites us all. Now I think we have Liko and Lalani.
Live from Waikiki, Kapiolani Park, by the Gandhi statue.
Oh. Right there. Every Tuesday at the Cove, in Diamond Head Cove, Ava Bar on Tuesday nights, Liko and Lalani play. So we're going to hear some great Hawaiian music and drink some great Ava. I go down there. It's over here, just up the road at the Cove. Here are my wonderful friends, Lalani Teal, and my other wonderful friend, Liko.
I thank Kavika for the day, yeah, and all of you folks. And yeah, it's been going on a long time. Maybe there's some people who have been here back in the 70s when it seemed like the, you know, environmentalists were kind of up on top of the game, and but things kind of slipped away a little bit. And but never say die. And so I got so many songs about this issue. It's hard to choose which one. So if you got the time, we got the songs, and we'll play some. Come over here. Okay. Test. Something is well, that's the technology stuff. And I've been up on Kauai, you know, travel all over the world. And one recent song, especially last year when the GMO thing and the people of Kauai became kind of cut the island in half, you know. And it was a song about, imagine showing up to work and all of a sudden somebody came and sprayed and everything in the river is dead. And it's one of those songs, I'm sure. There's a lot of songs like this, and it's for a guy to call Mr. Spray Poison. My guitar, Oren.
Live at the Climate March rally, Waikiki Beach. Yeah, that's right here. On the island of Oahu in Hawaii.
Sacred land, and there'll be no
nowhere to run, nowhere to hide from the genocide. Creeping down the hills, into the fields, to the ocean side. And where we used to play and used to fish along the river sides. The only thing that we can do now is to run and to hide from Mr. Spray Poison. Spray Poison. Spray Poison. Spray Poison. Who do you think you are? Now that you've gone that far, Mr. Spray Poison Man. Walking on the sacred land, Mr. Spray Poison Man. There was a family of prawns there at hand, the fishes in the stream, butterflies on the wing. Who do you think you are? Now that you've gone that far, Mr. Spray Poison Man. Walking on the sacred land, and there'll be nowhere to run, nowhere to hide from the genocide. Creeping down the hills, into the fields, to the ocean side. Where we used to play and used to fish along the river sides. The only thing that we can do now is to run and to hide.
I never. You know.
Oh, hello, Ari.
Are we
back? Just turn it down, Ari.
Just don't touch it. Just
leave
it.
Turn it down. Just a hair. Just a hair, please.
Yeah, that's good. All right, thank you.
What do you sound? What do you like?
How about the daughter tell me it isn't so? It's kind of a little beat.
Okay.
This song is about, you know, I received a phone call from Kauai, and, you know, it's the middle of having a great day and such a horrific message that I didn't know what to think about it all. Somebody calls you and says, they just blocked all the rivers up in Kauai, and, you know, and the rivers are not running, and what's happening, you know? And so my world, it comes out in song, and so the song is Kailalan, and it's like you wish it wasn't so, you know, but
sad and so foreboding about the
rivers and the streams. You live up in the mountains. And as I sit and wonder why teardrops fall from my eyes. Tell me that it isn't so. Now tell me, what about the trees? Dragonflies, butterflies, and bees, and all the flowers in blue. Sweet monkey honey perfume. It says
time I left Hawaii, this was actually when the environmentalists were really strong at the end of the 70s. The last song, and a song called A Merry-Go-Round. Okay, well, this is another song from that time. I was in Los Angeles when the first Earth Day, and this is a song from that time. From the middle of my heart, my soul is crying out to
to the middle of your heart, and soul I sing. This earth is getting tired of being scarred and hurt, my friend. Oh, let earth live and live and live again. Earth Day 1980s in Los Angeles. An old world meets the new world on the battlefield. Someone sold a war without warning us, and Mother Earth, she's screaming fiery tears. To let Earth live and live and live again. Oh, let Earth live and live and live again. All around I hear the sound of the newer pilgrims here. Classified, capitalized on. Oh, my dears, back in the garden, Mother Nature weeps, 'cause Earth Day's coming faster than we think. So let Earth live and live and live again. Oh, let Earth live and live and live again. So from the middle of my heart, my soul is crying out. To the middle of your heart and soul I sing. This earth is getting tired of being scarred and hurt, my friend. Oh, let Earth live and live and live again. Let Earth live and live and live again. Oh, let Earth live and live and live again.
So thank you, folks, for, you know, still being here, and for the old and the new and for the future. Thank you, David, for this day. Aloha. Aloha.
Thank you. We just have a few more speakers.
There you go, Martin.
I think I'm, what happened? Our next speaker is, I'm being disconnected.
You're being orange.
How am I? Oh, I'm back on. Great. We have, sorry.
We have Chuck Burrows from the Hawaii Interfaith Power and Light. He's one of our co-sponsors of our march today. Chuck.
Hey. Thank you very much, David. And let's give David a great hand for putting this together, you know. It was amazing to have 150 of you coming out marching for climate change. And of course, our musicians, Leilani and Nico as well, for their performance here. I know this is getting to the last minute, everyone wants to leave, but I'll just have a few words. I'm Chuck Burrows of the Hawaii Interfaith Power and Light. And let me say a few words about the Hawaii Interfaith Power and Light. It got started some 18 years ago when Michael Bailey and also Steve Montgomery, wave your hand, were invited up to Canada, Oak Crow, Canada, to meet with the Alaskan indigenous people, such as the Gwich'in people, who are have been divided into the Canadian Gwich'in and all the Alaskan Gwich'in. So they wanted us up there to support, to save the Arctic Wildlife Refuge from oil drilling 15, 20 years ago. And they also have come to Hawaii, where we also have them speaking to our legislators and our people here to support their efforts. It's been a long, long, long road here. But I hope that it'll be, in a sense, ending up soon, because we've been trying to get our senators, Senator Schatz, well, in the past, with Senator Ikaka and Senator Inouye, to sign a bill to what designate the wildlife refuge as a wilderness area. They refused to do so because they were blood brothers with the Republican Alaskan senators. Can you imagine that? So we have now Senator Schatz, Senator Hirono, and so forth. And just past March, a few of us from Hawaii and from Alaska met with them to encourage them to sign the Senate bills to designate the Arctic Refuge as a wilderness area. We also spoke to Representative Gabbard and in passing to Representative Takai there. However, the most important thing is Senator Schatz has co-signed or co-sponsored the Alaskan Wilderness Bill to declare this a wilderness area. What does that mean? It means that if Congress okays it, no oil drilling in this sacred place. As the Gwich'in people have said, the wildlife refuge is a sacred place where people from Hawaii also have our sacred places. For instance, one of our sacred places is Kuanu'u Marsh, Ulupo Heiau. So we stand in solidarity with them. We also bring in other faith groups, and this is where the Interfaith Power and Light comes in. It is a natural organization composed of religious groups from the Buddhist, Jewish, Muslim, and many other religions, as well as indigenous people's spirituality as well. And we have formed, since 1907, the Hawaii Interfaith Power and Light. And you could go on the website to find out more about the activities that's coming up now, especially in this climate change summit in Paris. And that's the reason why we are here, to support this effort as well. So go online to find about that. And also, we'll be having a meeting with Senator Schatz in his office, since he has co-sponsored the Wilderness Bill, with our polar bears here. And let's thank the Alaskan Wilderness League, the Sierra Club of California, who has sent to us the polar bears to wear on these occasions. So I would like to thank all of you for coming today, and the work continues on to save our creation, Paloma Aina, and especially Aloha Aina, to have the love for the land, which we all care for. Mahalo to all of you.
Yo, yeah, yeah, bravo, bravo. Yeah. Thank you, Chuck. Now we have Elsie Love. Elsie Love's going to introduce herself.
Hello, everyone. I'm Elsie Love, and I am a co-leader of the Honolulu chapter of Citizens Climate Lobby. And I know everyone is ready to head out, so I'm just going to very briefly explain a little bit about carbon pricing and what we do at Citizens Climate Lobby. So at Citizens Climate Lobby, which is an organization with chapters across the United States and some overseas as well, we advocate for a carbon fee and dividend policy. So this is a way of putting a price on carbon so that the price tag reflects or is closer to reflecting the actual cost. And so how it works is there is the fee, which is what steers us away from fossil fuels. And how it would work is a fee would be charged to industries extracting or importing fossil fuels. The fee would start at about $15 per ton of CO2 emissions and increase by $10 a year every year from there. And this fee would help make renewables more competitive and send a very clear market signal to investors and industry that it is time to move away from fossil fuels. The dividend part protects the economy and protects lower income families as we make the transition to renewable energy. And so how the dividend works is, so all the money that was collected from the fee would be divided and given to families on an equitable basis. So everyone would get the same amount. So if you use less fossil fuels, you could be getting back more in your dividend than you're spending on increased energy costs or fuel costs. And so that will help people make the transition. There's been an independent economic modeling firm that's done a study on such a policy, and they have found that 2 out of 3 families would get back in their dividend as much or more as they're spending on increased costs. They also found that such a policy would lower CO2 emissions to 50% of 1990 levels in just 20 years. So at Citizens Climate Lobby, we are advocating for a national level policy, but also recently here in Hawaii, we've started advocating for a state level policy. British Columbia has implemented a similar policy, and it's been very successful in reducing their fossil fuel use. An added bonus is that a carbon fee and dividend policy has bipartisan appeal. It's a market-based strategy, and it does not grow the size of the government. So I think it's the best chance we have of achieving bipartisan consensus and action. If you're interested or in getting involved or want to learn more, you can come see me. Thank you.
Now we have Michael Bailey. And Michael's going to introduce himself. We have one more speaker. We have Liz Reese, and we're going to have a little rapping here.
We'll keep this short. We'll keep this sweet. Obviously, we're down to the hardcores now, right? So we're getting down to the people that have helped organize this event, gather their communities together, gather their friends together, and hold on. And this is very important for us to understand, for the hardcores especially, is that we have to create a sustainable world. The key thing to that is to sustain ourselves. We have to sustain our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our connection with other people. And because when we face the challenges of climate change and face the reality, as I was commenting to several people today, the reality is that in less than 100 years, the spot I'm standing in now is going to be sand, right? This will be seawater floating in here in the high tides. That's going to happen. Okay. And we need to accept the fact that it's going to happen only if we allow the world to continue its present way, present path. But we need to change it quickly for that not to happen. And even if that does happen, even if we understand that those things can occur, there's even worse things that can occur. So we need to do whatever we can now to even save it at that level. This is where sustainability of our own hearts, minds, spirits, souls come in. We need to be enthused and inspired. My background, I'm with the original members of Greenpeace, original board members. I was the youngest person on the international board in its history, ran the expeditions to save the whales and the seals, and I've done many other things. You'll find me on the cover of the 1990 National Geographic magazine, August, in the oil fires in Kuwait, doing a separate environmental project there where we were saving the nature, stopping the oil well fires, other things. You can Google me online, Michael Bailey, Planet Views. I'm a known miscreant. I was one of the original trainees by Al Gore. When Al Gore did the Inconvenient Truth, and he first started off his first group of trainees, first couple hundred people, I was in that body, and we helped establish the Climate Project, which is now the Climate Reality Project, which now has 7,000 trainees around the world, thousands of people in India and China and other parts of the world helping make the climate movement happen. But to do these things, we need to sustain ourselves. Music, a beautiful thing. Friendship, camaraderie, laughter and joy and mirth, okay? We need these elements in our life to take on the challenging situations we face and use our minds, our intellect, our hearts to make changes and to keep at it. If you look upon the past of humanity, great movements of the world, even religious movements, are largely based upon people coming together, singing songs, enjoying their camaraderie, sharing strategies together. in order to make a change in the greater good for the greater good of humankind. That's my message right now. Thank you so much. I'm going to the next speaker. But think sustainably, think above ourselves. Thank you much.
Thank you, Michael. And we have Liz Reese. She's with World Can't Wait. Longtime activist. She works her Okoli off. She's just really hard at doing things for peace and justice. Here's Liz Reese.
Hey, everyone. I want to keep it kind of short. First, you know, I think it's really important that we're out here today across the globe. People are marching, demanding a better world and a better future for this planet. I also have to give a shout out to protesters in Paris. As people probably know, people were banned from protesting and participating in Paris, demanding a real climate change talk, and I'm going to get into that. But righteously, people ignored that ban. They were out in the streets today. As of this morning, hundreds of people were arrested, and police were using tear gas and being very violent on people. So I think it's really important to call out what that is, because, you know, hundreds of thousands of people were scheduled to march on the streets and really calling out the hypocrisy for what's happening at the UN climate change, which is basically capitalist, imperialist countries dividing out a better world for themselves and their interests and screwing over poor countries and poor people. You know, a lot of people celebrated when Obama rejected the Keystone XL pipeline. Now, it's a good thing that it was rejected, but let's be very clear why he rejected it. The slogan of World Can't Wait is humanity and the planet come first. Now, that was not Obama's motive. Obama and the US ruling class does not put humanity and the planet first. In fact, Obama was very clear. His quote was, "It would not serve the national interests of the US." You know, how much more clear do you have to be about what's really behind the motivation for doing away with this pipeline? And part of that national interest is Obama going into Paris, being one of the top leaders and the top dogs in these negotiations. And if he approved the Keystone XL pipeline, then he really wouldn't be able to do that. So it was really about showing face and serving the national interests. I'm glad that people mentioned the military, because it's really important when you're talking about the planet and the environment, you can't ignore what the U.S. military is doing. The U.S. military is the largest single institutional consumer of oil in the world. And it's really important that we talk about what the military is doing, not just to the environment, but to humanity and people worldwide. You know, a part of me is really disgusted and thinks it's sick to watch Obama go into these climate talks in Paris as we're dropping bombs in Syria. So I think it's important to bring all these attacks together. You know, we want to fight for a better world and a better planet, then we have to start talking about all these issues. And the last thing I want to leave you with is, you know, people also need to connect these issues. When you look at the police murders that are happening across the U.S., I have been so inspired by people righteously taking to the streets and demanding justice for people who have been murdered by police. So if we want to talk about a better planet, then we have to include police terror and police murder in that. So I want to encourage people to check out World Can't Wait. We're taking out all these issues. And the slogan, humanity and the planet come first. Thank you.
Okay, we're live.
And last up, then we have a little more music. We have Jay Guns, who's going to do a poem for us, I think. He just met me here in the park, and I think he's got a nice poem.
How y'all doing out there? All right. Yeah, I'm with a group called Guerrilla Republic. We're a worldwide organization. We basically fight for the people, not the corporations. We're a grassroots-based. And we basically try to reach the youth through hip-hop and try to put a kind of a message out there instead of gin and juice. So I just wanted to speak a little bit about the war. This is from our brother that's on death row. His name is Mumia Abdul-Jamal.
Mumia!
The war against us all. This war in Iraq isn't the end. It's the beginning of wars to come all around the world at the whim of the neocons in the White House. This is the Bush doctrine come to life. War, war, and more war. War brought to you by the big corporate masters who run the show. This isn't just a war on Iraqis or Afghanis or Arabs. This is or even Muslims. It's ultimately a war on us all. That's because the billions and billions that are being spent on this war and the cost of tanks, rockets, bullets, and yes, even salaries for the 125,000 plus troops is money that will never be spent on education, on healthcare, on reconstruction of our crumbling public housing, or to train and place the millions of workers who have lost manufacturing jobs in the past 3 years alone. The war in Iraq is in reality a war against the nation's workers and the poor, who are getting less and less, while the big defense industries are making a killing, literally. What's next? Iran, Syria, North Korea, Venezuela? We've already seen the corporate media play megaphone to the White House to build and promote a war based on lies. War is utilized by the imperialists first and foremost to crush internal enemies. We are seeing the truth of its insight when we see the sad state of American education. The rush of seniors to buy affordable medications from the Canadians because American drugs are just too expensive. The threat of privatization of Social Security and the wave of repression that comes with an increasingly militarized police. This is a war on us all. And the struggle against war is reality, a struggle for a better life for the millions of folks who are here in need in this country. The fight against the war is really a fight for your own interests, not the false interests of the defense industry or the corporate media or the White House. Down with the wars of empire. From Death Row, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal. Peace and blessings, y'all. Solidarity.
One, two, three. Mumia Abu-Jamal. We've got to tear down the prison wall.
All right. I don't know if you folks know, but the war in Syria is about climate change. What happened was there's a drought in Syria, and the people moved into the city. And when they got into the city, the government was very repressive, and the people revolted. And that is how the war started. And so this is about climate change. And we are responsible here in the United States because we also, George W. Bush, created ISIS. And so we are totally responsible for that war and for those refugees. So I think we need to make that connection, that climate change is why that war is going on. And I think Liko is going to do a few more songs, and we're going to wrap it up. But I want to thank you all so much for coming. Sherry Pollack designed all of the flyers and stuff. She's very humble. It's her birthday, but don't tell her I told you.
Oh,
it's Sherry's birthday. It's Sherry's birthday. Thank you to Liko and to Lalani, yeah. To all our fabulous speakers, to Doug and his gorilla video. He goes live stream for us. And for everyone who came today, for Hank showing up last minute, thank you, Hank. And Michael Bailey, Doc Burrows, just the number of people who came here today and helped out. The Bernie group, we had the Bernie babes here earlier with their signs. I want to thank them. Oh, Oren. Oren, oh my God. Oren is the rock. All of this that happened today, all this equipment, he got up before dawn, before God, he woke up God to tell him the world was starting. And he built this thing. And our polar bears, gotta thank Docs. Oh, Alana for taking our photography. And each one of you is an activist. We're all here because we are all activists. Every one of you here today is gonna make a difference. You are making a difference. I've been in a lot of different actions and a lot of different campaigns and movements. And this is how it happens. So you throw your pebble in the pond, you don't know how far the ripples go out, but you do affect, you do make change. So everything you do is effective, it is gonna make a difference. So thank you. Here's Liko and Lalani.
Liko Martin and Lalani Keo.
They're at the Cove every Tuesday night. Abba.
8 to 10. Happy birthday to you.
Somebody's birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Sherry. Happy birthday.
take you back to the 70s. I was on the Big Island, and a woman by the name of Kathy Dorn was putting together a strategy to stop the cesium-137 and the cobalt-60 from coming into the Big Island, because it was going to be really convenient to store it in this big, this aquifer, a river that comes down from Mount Ocal. And, you know, so anyway, it was, they had a really good team, and they went to the legislature, and, you know, it wasn't sounding like such a great idea after a little while, but this is one of the songs that that I wrote for that time. And I think that, for sure, not thinking, but what about the nuclear bombs? You know, man, that's the ultimate wipeout, and Hawaii will be no more. For many years, I've looked at Hawaii, and it's like, well, we're just a target. And the power of neutral thinking, neutrality for Hawaii was once a neutral territory. It still is. It's just been violated by the military powers of the world, and that's one of the issues that will come about with the restoration of independence in Hawaii. It was foreseen by the kupuna here that Hawaii should be neutral because it's a convenient stepping stone, and that's exactly what happened since 1893. More wars have been launched and exploitations have gone into Asia, and they even launched straight out of here, straight into the Middle East. And so this song is, you know, the endangered species we are.
We're just going to play two songs. And mahalo everybody so much for coming out and for being here. Right on. Showing the energy and taking the time. And that's what we need to do to make for real this awesome thing, so that we can get off the endangered species list.
Sometimes I wonder just how long will it take us all to become the endangered species. All I'm asking for, a little compassion. Think about the future. Think about the children. What kind of world are we going to live? A nuclear war. Are we really going to go that far? Fighting for oil and gold. No, we need fighting for the moon and the stars. You know, we're fighting for nothing at all. Sometimes I wonder just how long will it take us all to become the endangered species.
species. And oh, oh, you know I want to run. Yes, I want to get away back into the garden, but I can't. No, I just can't walk away, not until the future is secure. Sometimes I wonder just how long to become the endangered species, endangered species, endangered species. So tell me, what can a poor man do to keep on loving you? Oh, what can a poor man say? Come on, help me from being irradiated in a nuclear war. I'll for oil and gold, you know we're fighting for the moon and the stars. No, we're fighting for nothing at all. Sometimes I wonder just how long.
Kind of a big ticket item, but it's kind of at the top of the list. And so,
mahalo everybody for coming out today. All right, okay, we've come to the end of the event pretty much. So this is our last song, unless David wants to come up and do something at the end. Okay, so I guess this is our last song for the day. And this is for everybody who shares this good earth. And mahalo nui loa for all of your work, your feet, getting out there and loving this beautiful place.
And the wind and the
storms are my friend. The ocean is so vast, and time quickly passes. You are the child of your dreams. How can you make it last? And it's a cool earth, and this can be a good life, and this can be the right place, and this can be the right time to find a little peace for your heart. And as I look into my heart, I found something waiting there, as waters from a spring brought life to all things there. And as the birds and bees and dragonflies entwine serenity and peace, did I find burning deep within dragonflies entwined
and beast did I find burning deep within the fire of the
One more time, Nico Martin and Lalani Teal. Duck Cove, every Tuesday night, 8 o'clock. Go down, have a wonderful time. And if anybody would like some pallets, they're up for grabs. Nice so you can fix your bathroom floor with these. Okay, aloha everyone.
Aloha. Hey, nice seeing you. You're back from recording? Yes, I am still recording.
Still recording.
I can stop right now. I'm using...